Good evening, everyone. Welcome to day 5 of the webinar series D for Drones. And today we are going to be taking it a little more interesting level. Day 1, we spoke about the why of the whole project, why we need Project Wings, why we need to educate our students and our schools to have drones in their curriculum. And on the day 2, we discussed the how of it. We discussed how we can create these mini ecosystems in the schools, and we can make it easy for the educators to be a part of the whole drone program. Day 3, we discussed about the safety and security. And day 4, we spoke about the inclusivity and equitability. Today, we are going to be talking about three important aspects in the drone industry. That is, number 1, internships. Number 2, jobs. And number 3, entrepreneurship. And to talk about this, today we have on our panel some amazing speakers who will be sharing their journey, sharing their vision, and sharing their insights with us. So the first speaker of the day is Captain Nikunj Parashar from Sagar Defense Engineering, who will be sharing his entrepreneurial journey with us. Then we have Nupur Seth from Idea Forge, who heads the HR department in Idea Forge. And she will be talking about how, as an industry, they are accommodating more interns and more jobs for the drone sector. Then we have Rachit Bhatnagar from Aeronautical Sector Skills Council of India, who will be talking about the aeronautical aspects of the skills, that what exactly are the skills that we should be looking for while giving the drone education. So let's start our day today. The first speaker of the day is Captain Nikunj. Captain Nikunj, I welcome you to this webinar series and thank you for being a part of it.
Thank you so much, Ruchi, for the same. And give me 5 seconds.
Yes, please. Before we begin, I request everybody else to put off their videos and their audio so that we can have a focus on Captain Nikunj.
Hey, hi, very good evening to everybody. And thank you, Ruchi, for this opportunity to put across my journey, my story. And I entered the drone industry by accident. So my journey. So this is what I'm going to say here. I failed. And this is the time when we are getting, a lot of people are getting their results for their board exams across the country. And I failed in my physics, chemistry, and maths. One of the three most important things, if you're going to work in the drone industry, you need all these three basics, very important. And you should really be good at it. But I actually failed there. And that's where my whole life changed, because I could not do engineering to start off with. And I moved on to journey of joining SEAS. And generally they say is the black sheep of the family joins out at sea. But so it was not the case. And I joined sea out there, served on board a lot many ships, more than 14 years out at sea. But somewhere down in my mind, I had always the thought process of, you know, going back to my engineering skills. And that's where through the whole journey of my sailing, the whole journey of my process of becoming from a cadet, going all the way, coming up the ladders of 14 years, I went on to become a master. Mariner, and I completed my engineering in due course. What I realized was my passion was not only sailing, but my passion was how could I bring a difference to the industry which I was. Because when you're out at sea, at times you are quite lonely. In COVID times, you would have heard out there that a lot of seafarers are more than 10 months, 11 months out at sea, and they are not getting an opportunity to be repatriated back home. So my thought process was, how could I, you know, bring every sailor back home, and, you know, in a way that he doesn't need to go out at sea. And that was what my love of my life. And that's where my startup started off. So Sagar Defense was formed, and Sagar Defense was formed with just one viewpoint in mind. And that was autonomous shipping. I was working on systems which could run boats unmanned. Boats which were not only small in size, but grow up in size. Over the years, God has been very kind, and I've been able to do some few bigger vessels in this regard. And that's where, you know, when you do this journey, you are never alone. So if I say I started as a sailor, I failed, but I started as a sailor, quit sailing, came back, started my startup. Was I doing it all alone? Then I'm going to lie about it. it's never been possible. So that's where my team came into picture. And team plays a very important role, you know, and that's a core part of entrepreneurship and entrepreneurship is team. Without team, who are your assets, you can never move the next step. You may conquer certain distance on your own. Maybe the vision is yours, but the most important and practical aspect of it is your team. So that's where my team came into, you know, all together. And that's how we were able to cover these steps. But what we realized was drone industry was picking up in India. And somewhere in early 2016, you know, I met Ankit Mehta of IdeaForge. And we were together as success stories on the CII platform. Ankit was being felicitated for his UAV adventure, which he's been doing. And I was being felicitated for my maritime systems. And I looked at it and I said, wow, this is something I never thought about. I came back home, still sat over it for next year. And that's where, you know, your team plays an important part. Certain assets, certain sectors where you're not looking into it is where your team comes across. So my co-founder came across to me and said, Nikunj, why can't we adapt our technology also into the aviation front? And remember, the second part of entrepreneurship is, do you have courage also to let go some of your ideas in? And that's very important. So I'm a core mariner, a hardcore mariner, you know, blue blood. I have sea waters in my blood, I would say, very happily. But then getting into aviation was altogether a different thought process. I had no experience. But my co-founders were ex-NASA, and they said that, you know, look, we're satellite guys. Why can't we do something on aviation? And then the whole journey of aviation started off. And it went from one aspect to the other. So if you look at a product point of view, we have been customizing and developing as per the need of the hour. And this is the biggest question. What's the opportunity in the aviation sector? What is the opportunity in the drone sector? We all need to think about it because, you know, it's very easy to go out there, pick up some open source products in and build up an UAV. But how do you sustain? This question you need to think over and over again when you're going to jump into an UAV business, because everything seems very easy out there. But trust, these big guys, the people like IdeaForge, Asteria, who have been already working for more than 10 years, they have really toiled hard to be there what they are. So it's just not easy to go out there and compete against them. They are in best in what they do. So we also started looking into certain sectors. And you know, when you again take your team together, everybody has their own idea. Some say, why don't we do drone delivery? Some says, why don't we go out there and drop bombs out of it? Important for every one of you who is listening to it, who is trying to do and create a name for himself in the drone industry, you need to pick up the right track. What are the right opportunities? Is the logistic right opportunity as of now? Is the medical drone delivery the right opportunity as of now? Or is it the security surveillance or commercial drone applications? The sector is very wide open, and it's wide open to each one of you. And as a master, and that's what we call ourselves as seafarer, is jack of all trade, master of none. You know, as a sailor, we need to do a lot many things out there. So we are expert in navigation, but there are other things also we carry out. It's the same way it's happening around in the drone industry. When you pick up a drone, you would feel capable of doing many things. But my one suggestion out here is restrict yourself, develop on few potentials. That potential may be in cargo, that potential may be in certain logistics, that potential may be in security surveillance, but pick up that one value proposition and work very hard onto it. And that is very important. Coming to internship out there, companies like us are always looking for promising candidates out there who can come across and work. Very important for candidates to come and understand, not only in a development mode, but also when you're looking for internship, you have to find out that what are you interested in? Are you looking at mechanical designs to work on? Are you looking at electronic? Or you're looking at a go-to-market strategy which you're going to learn in? And these are certain criteria which is very important for you to go out there and ask the company and ask people like us, you know, team members and companies like us, that, hey, look, this is my area of interest. Would you give me an internship opportunity in this regard? Because at times, people also have a fear that, you know, what they are building up could be exposed into the market. And I always say that if your trade is so easy, you know, if your intern walks in and he's going to look at it and copy it, then it's not worth being in the business. So it's the same way for everybody out there. Don't think that assembling few of the drones would make you one of those drone companies. But it's important is you look at it in a very serious way, in a very professional way, and then try to develop a product in. And this is very possible if you work around. There are a lot of companies, and the beauty is, right now in India, there are a lot of budding companies out there who are developing super technologies in the area of drone. And there's a humongous opportunity of internship in that regard. So at Sagar Defense, I'm very open for people also to reach out to us and look at what their interest is. Most important is your core focus in which area you're going to work should be very properly highlighted across to the company. Because at times, internship can also be abusive because we could use you in a term as a cheap labor. So don't allow yourself to become a cheap labor. That's very important. And that can only happen if there is a give and take relationship. And that is in terms of what kind of knowledge you would like to bring on and what you're ready to work on to it. And with that, I would like to end up. Thank you, Ruchi.
Thank you so much, Captain Sikunj. This is really inspiring. And before we go to question answers, we would complete all the presentations. And now we have Nupur Seth, Nupur from Idea Forge. Nupur, I welcome you to this webinar series and I request you to share your views with us.
Thank you, Ruchi. It's a pleasure to be the part of the forum today. Just give me a minute to present my... So good evening, everyone. Drone industry is rapidly growing segment and is becoming an integral part of many high-tech industries today. So let's have a quick bird's eye view of few numbers of the industries, how the industry is going. Today, drone industry is at $22.5 billion and with a CAGR of 14% approximately, it is expected to reach $42.8 billion by 25. It is expected that the sales will double. Interestingly, Asia Pacific is expected to be the largest market. And you will be surprised to know that there are more than 700 plus applications in the enterprise sector itself. By enterprise, I mean applications in railways, oil, mining, etc. So stay with me on the slide and let's understand where the drones are being deployed currently. Some of the applications are like agriculture, traffic management, homeland security, forest protection, disaster management, urban development, enterprise survey, and healthcare. I am proud to mention that Idea Forge has been able to deploy its drone for most of these services. A few applications which are very crucial are like disaster management. Very, very crucial because places where you can't expect a human being to supply essentials, you can actually deploy a drone to send some essential materials like food, water, etc. Also, to just give you an example about traffic management, how can you control traffic? So there is a lot of data present to manage the traffic and other basis the data that is available through real images. Recently, Idea Forge has deployed a traffic in a highly densely populated area called Dharavi in Mumbai to control and monitor the crowd, especially to maintain the social distance at the time of COVID. So these are crucial applications of drone that exist. Now let's understand where the future is moving. And when I'm saying future, it's actually not that far. It's coming closer day by day. These are some of the crucial applications where drone industry has already started experimenting. And there is a lot to do because there are a lot of data mining that is expected. There is a lot of image processing that is expected. So what is supply drop? It's about dropping one material from one place to the other. Then some other applications are like surveillance of power sector, infrastructure, farming, monitoring the construction progress and land survey. So when you talk about construction, that's a very big industry. Construction business is using drones every day and the numbers are increasing. They wanted to have a landscape view of their projects. How do they monitor that? How do they capture the construction progress? Infrastructure planning. There are many smart cities that are using drones to plan a city in a better way. You will also be happy to know that drones are being also deployed to prohibit some of the illegal activities. For example, landmines, liquor, and also used for disaster management, which I just spoke about, counter-tax, border security, very, very crucial area. So Mr. Nikunj mentioned about Navy also. Air Force is there. Army is there. They all are using drones today and they're looking forward for much better applications. And please note that when I'm mentioning each application opens a job opportunity for you. Opportunity to manufacture a drone, opportunity to deploy the drone there, and of course, an opportunity to sell. So there are different fields that is attached to each of these. The third picture, what you're seeing on the screen is the real-time image where the drone was deployed in Dharavi. Let's move to the larger ecosystem. What can we do to protect our aquatic life? There are n number of species, whether you talk about plants, whether you talk about fishes. How can we monitor these? Is it humanly possible? Drones can be used to monitor and also save the endangered species. Autonomous indoor drones. What I mean by indoor drones is I'll just help you understand by an example. If there is a fire in a building, fire brigade will come. It will do its job of spraying the water. But what about the people who are stuck there? How can you find them? Drones have a perfect application here to locate a particular person and you can help protect lives. Then supplies, I mentioned. Repair services. As the first slide spoke about that the numbers will double in the next 5 years. There is a huge market which will be about corrective maintenance, preventive measurement, and repair. And the medical facilities. Can we supply medical facilities with the help of drone? Now, when I'm talking about all these applications, they have three things in common. What are those three things? They will ensure safety of life, less operational cost, and more precise monitoring. So even some of the other applications which ensure these three things can be drone taxis, complex inspection, infrastructure inspection, other opportunities in terms of job. Can you develop an app on your phone that you can use to fly the entire drone? If you are interested in a noble profession of teaching, can you open an institute for pilots, for training pilots, for people who can learn what drones are all about and provide certificates to that? So these are huge markets. So whenever I take interview, I generally ask this question to the candidates. What do you look for when you are looking for a job? The answers are these three: stability, job security, and financial security. Financial security, of course, because you with today's generation just don't want the needs to be fulfilled, but they want the wants to be taken care of. So let me tell you that when you will get a job, most of you will find these things a meeting. But if you don't join something that you enjoy doing, you will feel disoriented and there will be lack of job satisfaction. So I have a request to all those who are listening to this, that whenever you think of a job or you plan to do something on your own, that is you plan to start your business, please ensure that you have a passion to do that and you enjoy doing that. Will the drone industry provide you? It might, because your education, whatever you have studied, whether it's mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, electronics, ceramics, you will be able to apply that knowledge. You will get an opportunity to apply those fields. You will get good opportunity to work in the modern technologies like embedded systems, vision processing, artificial intelligence, etc. Now, some numbers. So you would be interested to know that what are the segments which are in demand today. where are the jobs? So these are some of the segments: platform manufacturers, where you manufacture the drone, software services, components, etc. I have also highlighted the fields where IdeaForge has provided internship in last 13 years. And this is another number which talks about a positive trend within a year in terms of jobs in different fields, which is software engineering, hardware engineering, sales, to the other jobs like pilot, finance, HR, and legal. So who wouldn't like to join and be associated with an industry which is a military innovation, which is your passion, and of course, a technology that is transforming different businesses. These are some of the testimonials that I thought I would share with you from IdeaForge, which talks about how much they are satisfied with the industry. They feel very pride that they are associated with an organization that gets an opportunity to serve a nation. They feel challenged that their skills are being developed and their potential is being explored to the large extent. So they feel happy about it. So if drone industry gives an opportunity with a common vision and a passion, I'm sure we'll be able to create a lot of jobs in these market. I'll just share some of our existing customers. And these are some accolades that we have got in the past. Thank you for your patience hearing. I will just like to close by saying that as an industry, let's try to become as Atmanirbhar as we can, reduce the imports of the parts and other products, and let's try to have Made in India stamp on all the products that we manufacture. Thank you and Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, Nupur. This was an amazing talk, and we would come back to you for the question answer. But before that, we would like to hear Rachit Bhatnagar from Aeronautical Sector Skills Council of India. Rachit sir, welcome to this webinar series.
Okay.
And I request
Thank you so much.
Put on your presentation so that we can hear you and we can see your vision as well.
Just a minute. I'm just putting my screen.
Yes, please. We can see it.
All right.
No, you need to not put on the presenter view because we can see your notes as well.
You're able to see my notes, is it?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
This is okay.
Okay.
No, not the presenter view. Not the presenter view.
All right. Okay.
This is it.
Okay.
That's it. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Good evening, everybody, especially Dr. Ruchi Saxena for introducing me. And I take this opportunity to thank you all the Electronic Sector Skill Council team also for organizing this wonderful event for all the educators and school students. Especially. So my part, I would take you along for the drone industry, skills, jobs, and entrepreneurship opportunities. My journey with aviation has been for a very a quick taking you to my journey, for a professional journey. I had joined Indian Air Force after engineering in my NIT Suratkal, which lies in Karnataka. I had done a small swift 1 year graduate engineer trainee at Saurashtra Chemicals Porbandar and then joined Indian Air Force as a technical engineer. And I did my training in Bangalore only at Air Force Technical College in mechanical stream. and I went on to do my helicopter training, which is manufactured by HAL. It's called Chetak and Cheetah helicopters, which is mostly used in very high altitudes and in also in Navy. Then I went on to serve in various parts of the country, pan India, length and breadth, and also did one deputation to Namibian Defence Force abroad for 2 years. I also did my high altitude posting for 2 years in Leh, which is presently a standoff point between China and India. After that, I retired 2 years back from Chandigarh, based repair depot, and then moved on and came to Bangalore. I joined Aerospace and Aviation Sector Skill Council in January this year. It's been 6 months now. A brief overview of what we do in Aerospace and Aviation Sector Skill Council. It is one of the 37 sector skill councils, which is made under National Skill Development Corporation and set up under Skill India Flagship Program. This is supported by Government of India, and it is an industry-led initiative. Three of our major promoters being HAL, DCIC, and CIT. The role of ASCC is to connect with the industry, the government, the training provider, and the workforce. So we are the fulcrum in which we connect all these entities and try to create a system or a scheme for the short-term training under aerospace and aviation. We have set up a value chain with 5 subsectors, basically, which is like design and development, manufacturing and assembly, airline operations, airport operations, and manufacturing, repair, and overall. We are going to add now a 6th vertical under drone training. And we're trying to concentrate to start with the drone operator qualification pack. If you see, how the drones have grown over the years, from 1849, there was an introduction of explosive balloons used by Austrians, which was also, can be called as a drone. Anything which is, unmanned vehicle in the air, this can be called a UAS, RPA, or drones. Moving on, we had in 1900, we had something called Kettering bugs in 1930s. Then we had something called remote control models, RC models in 1990s. As we moved along, military started using the advanced drones, especially the fixed wing varieties, for various intelligence purposes. Starting with then again, after the military used, then the commercial industry realized we can use these drones for many other things. So then we have these drones which were used for filming and videography from 2010 onwards. Then Amazon announced that we can also deliver the various packages through drones. And then there was an explosion of so many commercial drone-based solutions. We are, mainly interested for the educators and for the school and colleges for the various variety types and categories of drones. The civil RPA, which is like remotely piloted aircraft, is categorized as per the DGCA. The regulator body is called Directorate General of Civil Aviation. They are the ones who are presently regulating all these civil aviation or commercial aviation aircrafts. So the drones are categorized in accordance with the maximum all-up weight. All-up weight is something called including the payload, the cameras, the other kind of packages we can carry, or whatever subsystems are there. Everything combinedly, it's called all-up weight, AUW. So the types are the nano, which is less than or equal to 250 grams, micro from 250 grams to 2 kgs, small one, which is from 2 kg to 25 kg. The medium variety is from 25 kg to 150 kg. And the larger variety, which is greater than 150 kgs. Presently, for all the educators and school-going children, I would like to emphasize that only the nano variety, which is only less than or equal to 250 grams, is permitted to be flown in the school or college premises without license. All other categories, from micro till large, you will have to obtain a license, a drone license, from DGCA. Various applications have already been covered by my fellow panelists. Still, I would like to go over to that quickly. As you must be knowing, that drones are being used in agriculture for various applications, for crop supervision, to crop maintenance, to compilation of plant count. Even for the damages in the agriculture crop, we do insurance, where certain the drones go about and calculate the actual real assessments of the discrepancies or fraudulent claims. We also did risk-adjusted product pricing. Media and entertainment, you are very, very well aware. It's used for aerial documentaries, for aerial photography, and right down to cinematography. For mining and very inaccessible places, we can do thermal imaging, we can do infrastructure and equipment inspection, or terrain mapping. For infrastructure, we do so many applications again: industrial inspections, for 3D video mapping, land audit, town planning, site management, and so many others. For the energy and utilities, we do remediation and site monitoring, inspection of underwater intake pipes, survey grade maps, and many other innovative applications are still emerging. ASSC has been working in drone subsector in many ways. We are trying to develop a short-term training ecosystem in association with the regulators and many other industry stakeholders. We are primarily working to make a qualification pack, maybe around average of 2 months, for basically a drone operator, especially for the battery-powered multi-rotor drones to start with. We are also trying to develop a training framework for other areas of demand also, like services, manufacturing, assembly subsector also. We are also collaboratively working for training of drones with other sector-scale councils, like we have agriculture, electronics, sector-scale council, retail, logistics, and so many and so forth. Because every sector-scale council or the industry bodies, basically, who are there in the scaling domain, have to develop the application-based qualification bags. Some of the job roles what we are looking at are pilot and drone operator, who will eventually grow into a specialist pilot. A photogrammetry executive will grow into a photogrammetry specialist. Also, we have opportunities for the repair technician, drone assembly technician, and besides that, in the design subsector, if you go for, who are basically will be designing various components of the drone, we have the opportunities for design engineer, mechanical systems, as well as design engineer, electrical and avionics systems. Drone opportunities for the jobs per se, if we can classify them into mostly four areas, they can be for drone flight operations or services. They can be for manufacturing, repair, and assembly. They can be for design and as well as for development and testing. I would like to tell you that for the internships, many of the their consortia of the companies which have been permitted by the DGCA to start doing beyond visual line of sight drone projects. Some of them are listed out here. These are some of the companies who will be doing these projects, and so there will be opportunities for the school students or the college students to approach them and take on internships. These are SpiceJet and AeoLogic, Dunzo you're quite familiar with, and AirMap Consortium. Dunzo is also backed by Google. We must be seeing the news. A lot of funding is coming from the Google for this. Asteria and AirMap Aerospace, ShopX Omnipresent, and Omnipresent Robotech Consortium. This is backed by Nandan Nilekani of Infosys. Then we have a famous Throttle Aerospace Systems in Boli. Then Sobica, Wingcopter, Avianca, and Indrone combined consortium. Andro Technologies, Daksha Unmanned Systems and AirMap, and Clear Sky Consortiums. So these all companies are working to begin beyond visual line of sight drone projects. You must be also aware of, you must be seeing in the news that some of the recent projects in which the drone applications have been done. Anti-locust operations in Rajasthan and UP last month. Drones are also used in surveillance operations in COVID-19 hit cities like Mumbai and Bangalore. In November 19, Coal India used drones to check illegal mining and pilferage. Also, the Indian Railways is using unmanned aerial systems for inspections and 3D mapping to bring to life a dedicated freight corridor. So with a network of 3,360 kilometers. Some of the upcoming projects are Indian Oil using its air surveillance for Delhi-Panipat pipeline. Survey of India has launched a very big program called Swamitva Scheme under Ministry of Panchayati Raj, in which the Abadi land is going to get mapped in India. Over 6.6 lakh villages are going to get covered by December 2024. With a target of every day, a mapping of 500 villages are going to be done by so many other agencies. So this is some of the areas. Lastly, there's one Maha Transco, which is a Maharashtra company, will be using drones for power line inspections in the remote areas of Maharashtra. So these are some of the projects and upcoming projects which the people, you know, the students and the educators will know that where all we can tell our people to, you know, do entrepreneurships, which all items we can, you know, manufacture ourselves under Make in India scheme or Atmanirbhar schemes, where we can pitch in to do, you know, supplying making the systems availability, and where the companies we can go for internships. Further opportunities are also there in the, like, continued reforms are coming up in regulations by government for use of drones in various applications. Government is planning to provide a very fast track approvals for the mass benefit use cases, especially in infrastructure, agriculture, healthcare, defense, and national security. So we all, like my fellow panelists were told, we have to push for Atmanirbhar Bharat, Make in India, Make for the World. And we must strive to make India a drone capital of the world. And with this, I would like to say thank you to the organizers, and thank you, and everybody, and Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, Rajit sir. This was an amazing presentation. I'm sure that everybody would definitely benefit from the inputs and the ideas that you have shared over here. Thank you so much, everybody, Nupur, Nikunj, and Rajit sir, for generously sharing your thoughts with us. I request the viewers who are watching us live, please put forward your questions if you have any so that we can address them. Meanwhile, I would like to ask a couple of questions to all of you. So you have been working with a lot of students and interns and entrepreneurs and youngsters, basically. Where is the major skill gap that you see, which has to be immediately filled up? Which are like the low-hanging fruits and which are the most important job skill areas that we should be looking at very quickly in the next few months?
I would like to answer this, Ruchi.
Yes, Nikunj.
So the low-hanging fruit in this case is especially in system integration, where you see a lot of sensors. Nowadays, everybody is moving towards making their drones as a cell phone. And the moment you go into that, that's where you're going to get your volumes. So the low-hanging fruit, especially even freshers coming out of college, can all start working on the ad hoc system, which has already been built in, so they can actually interface. So a lot in the electronic sector space, which is required. And along with that is somewhat on the mechanical assembly sections where you would require people in. So more from the mechanical diploma holders and ITIs, and along with that, hardcore electronic team members who can just come in to take it to the next level.
Great. Thanks, Nikunj. Where do you see the pilots of today lacking? I mean, what skills should the pilots develop in themselves that they can become better pilots for better drone pilots for all the complicated projects which Rajit sir has mentioned?
So as Rajit sir, he's ex-Air Force and I'm ex-Navy, and I'm a hardcore navigator. And Corona was the time when actually I went on to flights and see exactly how pilots operate, especially in Dharavi areas where we really worked for good 1.5 months, where I was there on ground. Pilots, what we call them pilots right now, you know, pilot is a very big word. And for me, what we are looking at the drone guys, we would call them operators, drone operators. So for them to actually turn into a pilot would have them a skill set where they're not only looking at visual operation of flying, but also they're able to see it electronically and software based. So the biggest difficulty which we faced, where we had few pilots who were actually drone pilots, but moment we got the drone out of sight, out of the visual line of sight, they were finding it very difficult to fly straight away looking at the electronic systems which they had. So the in turn, the skill sets have to be more developed on system flying rather than a visual flying. And that is where they need a lot of training in. So they have fantastic skill sets, and they call it something called an RPV mode, where they can see your video data coming in and they can fly in, or they visually look at the UAV. But moment you don't have a video and you don't have those data sets coming in, and you have just your electronic compasses and data sets for altitude coming in, and then you have to fly your drone, is where all the complications start. So a lot on electronic system flying is what this new group of drone operators would require to, because we are looking at urban flying conditions where a lot many time telemetry data sets or video data sets would not come in, or you're looking for cargo operations. So these system training is highly required in coming times. And if they are able to develop it, I think that's a tag when we'll start giving them as actual drone pilots. And that's where I would call them a drone pilot per se.
Thanks, Nikunj. One more question to all three of you, actually, because you all are related to defense somehow. And India is high on defense currently, and it's very important for us strategically to start strengthening our defense systems, and unmanned systems are going to be extremely important for that. So, Nupur, even your drones are used at extreme altitudes, and Nikunj, your boats are used in the deepest of the waters. And so you have flown, you have seen your jets and your helicopters fly in extreme conditions. So are youth ready for facing such situations when they are put in forth in the field? And what should they be start looking at? I mean, for example, if I'm working with kids, let's say 15, 16, 17 years of age, and we are trying to train them into vocational skills, what else should we be looking at for a 360-degree development of these children? You're on mute, Nupur.
I'll take that question. So most important thing is the will. And when I have spoken to the people who are in, say, training department or pilots who have gone and trained in extreme weather conditions, whether you say hot or cold or at the border, I think it is the pride which makes them feel that they are doing something different. So if the person doesn't have a will, whatever skill he can acquire, he will not be able to deploy his skills in those conditions. Then he can only be helpful within the city. For example, even in COVID, which Mr. Rachit was also mentioning about, when the drones were deployed, it was very difficult to get people because they are also not immune to Corona. So they can also get that. But it was the will to help the other people, will to help the forces, the police forces. So along with the skills, I think this is another necessity.
Great, thanks. Nupur, we also have an online question coming in from N. Sarvanan, who's asking, what's the main communication skill for a job in India? Is it English or Hindi? And actually, I would kind of ask as well, why are we so much stressing on English? Because Nupur, even we had a word on that. So talking about the corporate environment that India has been since the British had been a part of India, English is kind of highly overrated probably. But then, I have come across amazing guys from the core of India who don't have the best of English speaking skills. So how do we open up our job markets for them, make them a part of our families, and give them the confidence to go further?
So to give you a factual picture, when our people go in places at the borders or some, say, the tier two cities, they actually need to understand the local language also. So if you're going, say, south in India, if a person knows south language, it is actually beneficial. So I think if you have basic English and you understand the local language, it will be much easier for you to explain how the drone operates, because you train a person there and then you come back. So if you are good with local language, it is perfectly fine. Know your technical skills well and just have the basic understanding of English. That's all, because the terms that are written on the drone are still in English. The parts that are imported, they're still written in English. So at least you need to correlate those things.
Thank you. Besides that, do you also expect the job seekers to have good command of English so that they can be market ready or be sales ready or something like that?
The expectation is that you should be able to communicate in English. Suppose if we are also presenting, we are trying to do in basic English. When they are in colleges, their books are also in, it may be available in both the languages, but maximum are available in English. So if they have the basic knowledge, it will help. And that is my suggestion. Even when I go for hiring in different institutes, I have seen many students, they are technically extremely well. They've done coding, they have developed projects, but they're not able to express what they have done. So I think minimal requirement is that whatever you have done, you should be able to express this. And if there is a limitation, be candid in front of the interviewer that I don't know English. Can I speak in Hindi or Tamil or whatever is my language? I am sure the interviewer will be ready to accommodate your request, because the objective there is to understand that how skilled you are and what is your attitude. Rest all can be trained. Business communication, English, organizations are ready to train on that. Just have two things: be good in skill, and second is have an attitude to work and deliver. That's all is required.
And what about personality and interpersonal relationships?
These are two important things. So when you are representing your organization, certain basics of personality are expected. Certain how will you present yourself is required. And second point, sorry, what did you mention?
Interpersonal relationship.
So there, which is very important. So whether you are running a small shop, whether you're running a business, or whether you're employed somewhere else, unless and until you can work with people, you will not be able to excel to a large extent. There are very few jobs which are, you can say, like a unique skill, and the person is okay to work behind the scenes, and he'll be called specialist in this area. But if you want to run on a larger scale, I think interpersonal skill is a requirement today.
Would anybody else like to add to this? I would like to relate to my experience, actually. So we in Flying Labs, we have a tagline called the power of local. And we really believe in empowering the local communities and the youth from the local communities or the leaders from the local communities to take the responsibilities of wide-scale projects like the drone projects and conservation or disasters. Because we personally have experienced that, for example, when Nepal earthquake was struck, we had foreign drone pilots coming into Nepal and trying to act too smart, and that created more problems rather than solve the problems. So that's the reason Flying Labs were formed. The first Flying Labs was Nepal Flying Labs, and we are India Flying Labs. But then within India, I have seen that when I start working in, let's say, a state like Odisha or Nagaland or West Bengal or even Maharashtra for that matter, even though I'm from Mumbai, you know, when you work in these places, you still are an outsider. And people still trust the people who know the languages very well. I would give an example from the cyclone which had just struck in West Bengal. So had it been me in that place, I would not have gelled up with the local tribal people or even figured out what's happening in that place. But luckily, we had a local drone pilot from the same village who knew how to fly drones, who had a drone at that particular time, and he was incidentally in the same village. We could get good images and we could take the project further. But the idea is, again, you know, the challenge for me personally is not just local, how to get hyper-local in our approach. And when I mean hyper-local is, even in Mumbai, you have a place called Dahanu, which is about 100 kilometers from Mumbai. But go to Dahanu and come back to from Dahanu for even a single project, it takes one entire day, just for, let's say, 2 hours of flight. But, you know, had it been the youth from Dahanu who were trained in it, it would have been so much better for them to work on themselves. That's the whole goal of Project Wings. And for me, doing this entire skill development exercise with ESSCI is because we want to train as many people from the local villages as possible so that they can take over these projects wherever they are. And now we're talking about Swamitva Yojana, where the Survey Department of India would be going to every village to do the survey. why not have these youth from every village ready? Why should there be pilots who are traveling? Why do you need people to travel across 100 or thousands of kilometers to do one project? Where you can just pick up the local youth and give them the task, train them. So this is my vision for local and hyperlocal, and this is where we can probably cross the cultural and the language barrier as well. So this is just my input about it.
And I would like to add on to Ruchi in the same way. When we also, when you're developing, you know, a short term training and ecosystem qualification packs, what we call, we have been mandated to, you know, do in a translation of, you know, vernacular, all the vernaculars of the India, so that it goes into nook and corner and everybody can adopt that and understand it easily and implement it. Same way, just to add on to that, we should be supposed to be doing in all languages what we want.
Absolutely. And this is how probably we can sensibly scale up. Scale up is important, scale up is good, and scale up will happen anyhow. But then a sensible and a more scientific way of scaling up would be where we work with the local engineers, we work with local youth, and we train them into these skills, and they are able to do it themselves. That would be the best thing. And again, the vision is the way you have motorcycle repair shops in every corner, you should have a drone repair shop everywhere, so that everybody is enabled to do that. And more when we have Make in India drones like the Sagar Defense or like Idea Forge, it would be easy for us to understand the technology, get the spare parts locally within the country itself, and then do the repairs instead of sending it across to another country and then waiting for the imports to come back. What would you like to say about this, Nikunj? Unmute.
Yeah, no, I'm absolutely in agreement with you that, you know, this should happen. And when we have platforms which are made here, manufactured here in India, then we should have the capability of getting it, that, you know, our spare parts should be available in the normal market. So I'm in totally in agreement with that. And that is where your employment would come up. And that's where your youth would expand of adapting to the UAV network altogether. If we do not do this, then the ecosystem would not develop itself, or neither it will sustain. And then classic example of it, if you see DJI across, or you look at Parrot drones across, that's how they're expanding in. So important is for us to get our technology to that level where we can source it out to the people in the market and they can actually repair it. And that should be the quality of product also. And that's all what we all are trying to target, and hope that day comes pretty soon.
Thanks, Captain Nikhil. There is one more question about why the drone pilots, the number of jobs for drone pilots are very less compared to any other sector.
I think Nupur would answer this. I'll just add into it is, I do not see there is a less of drone pilots, actually. The job for drone pilots is actually quite high if you compare it within comparison to the technical requirement. Important is where the platforms are flying and what locations they are flying in, how far east corner or which part of the India, and what is the availability there. So at times it's very difficult for a company to manage or hire the pilot and then send it across. So if there are drone pilots who are able to do a freelancing, then nothing like that. So in coming time, I think the drone pilot job are going to increase every passing day, and less on the technical side, because once your tech spec has come up, then you're looking at bulk manufacturing and you'll have a core R&D team in any company. So more would be the drone pilots in there. COVID time actually proved that drone pilots are much more in need, more than the R&D and the manufacturing. So we had in Mumbai itself close to 50 to 60 pilots flying every day. While flying in Dharavi, we were not getting pilots to fly actually. So even Idea had their three team members who were actually in a car moving all across. I was myself on ground with my team because I was scared that they would get COVID. So I was working myself there. So I think the job for the drone pilots are quite humongous. It's only a little bit of time frame to clear that out. I don't see there should be a problem with that.
I would like to add on this, you know, and, you know, just, you know, say that pilots jobs are many, many, much more, you know, coming up. Like I also told Soumit the six scheme in which 500 villages are going to get mapped per day. So the requirement is much, much high. Only problem and issue is coming up is only the nano, which I had mentioned in my presentation, drones are requiring a pilot with no license. But from micro onwards, all the drones are coming in under the ambit of regulator, which is a DGCA. So under that, we have fixed, you know, number of FTOs in ecosystem of Indian aviation. This is called flying training organizations. under which the flying pilots are getting CPLs. Now, those FTOs are also being interested to give licenses for drone pilot license. In that regard, there's a lot of civil aviation regulations, which is called CAR, CAR in normal aviation, is under vetting and under review, is going to get enforced. So when a person has to fly any category of drone other than nano, he has to undergo a training system and at least a minimum 5 days program under a drone FTO, and then he will get a license. The system is slightly becoming slightly regulated in this regard, because there are security threats. If anybody start flying a drone, they would do so many things which we can't imagine only. So in that regard, a lot of regulations are coming up. This is the issue in which pilots are slightly less. But I would like to take this opportunity now to know the youth which is seeing, who's seeing this program, to invoke them and challenge them, basically, that the drone pilot is not the only job. Like the flying pilot people aspire for because it's a glamorous job, I would like to tell them there's a lot of other areas in which I have also mentioned in my presentation. The manufacturing of drones, various components, servicing and maintenance is a huge job. And if you will see very currently the kind of standoff we are with China, and you will find a lot of integrators and aggregators and drones are not able to do their job because some lot of components which are coming from China, the supply chain has been stopped. So I would like to invoke again the educators to basically motivate the students to work on the materials, the composite material which is used in drone manufacturing that should be produced in India. People are not able to do that. So many other components, the motors, variable motors and the composite materials, variety of composite materials which are used, propellers, and those thing items should be produced in India. So people should get an interest and start manufacturing those things. That would be my point. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Rachir. Also talking about the remuneration part, I have come across many of the drone pilots who get paid like peanuts. They get paid 10 to 15,000 a month, and they are aspiring to earn 75,000, 50,000, 1 lakh a month, 1.5 lakhs a month. So what should they be looking at developing in themselves to even aspire for such a kind of pay scale?
Nupur, you're from HR. I think you should answer it, and then I'll follow on after that.
Okay. So I don't agree to it completely. I think the remunerations are quite decent when you talk about engineers if they are flying, but if they are ITI who have got drone certificates, the remuneration are comparatively lesser. So it is what is backing them is the educational degree also makes a difference. And further adding to that, that how can they actually look at higher remuneration is that how can they understand how a drone is manufactured? What goes into the entire product? How are they flying? As Mr. Nikunj mentioned about that, how can you do the image processing better? So they lose sight and they start looking at the drone. But can you look at the entire system and do that? So when all these skills will be clubbed in one package, I'm sure the remunerations will be improved for that particular individual.
Nupur, I'm a doctor. I'm not an engineer.
Judge me? No, sorry, I was giving a comparison between an ITI and an engineer there.
Absolutely in agreement with Nupur on this side, because Ruchi, what we have to look at is what kind of platform they are flying in. What is the requirement of platform and what conditions they are going to fly in? Now, there is a simple broad, that's why I said that we have to, understand the word pilot. And then we need to really take a deep essence of that word called pilot, because we as a navigator also, when we start to take up a local job, there is a pilot who comes on board and who takes our vessel inside a harbor. Why he's called pilot? Because he's a specialist. He has a complete technical know-how of that harbor area to get my vessel in. And I'm a captain. So, the comparison of calling some of them a pilot is something we need to understand. And this phrase has, in the drone industry has been taken up very easily. So whoever can fly the drone, take it up left, right is a pilot. My 7-year-old son does that pretty well, actually. So he flies that. Now, I cannot call him a pilot. So he's a good operator for a small drone. So the same way, those skill sets are very important. His certification grades are very important. So as sir rightly said, that these certifications would be coming in, and then these certification would be progressive, because from a 3 kg UAV, when you move across to a 80 kg UAV or a 55 kg UAV, the bracket changes, his experience changes, and flight dynamics also change. Because, and there would be a contributing factor to it. Somebody would come and say, hey, look, the autopilot is flying it. I do understand the autopilot is flying it, certainly. But then the risk element which is there with it, I have to always keep that in mind. Because if somebody is flying my 55 kg all up weight platform over a space where there is a village on one side and I have a field on one side, and if there is an emergency situation comes, what he is supposed to do? He is supposed to crash the platform on the field or right into the village? These are the calls which has to be taken, and this can only happen when you upskill up. So salary bracket will always depend on the skill sets, will always depend on the qualification level of certification he is having in. And certainly if he is an helicopter pilot, yes, he demands that price. But yes, if somebody has come from an ITI and he's going again up to a rank of helicopter pilot, nothing like it. But if he's a 3 kg pilot or a 2.5 kg platform pilot, certainly he may not get. He may become an individual proprietor where he can go out and carry out freelancing job and he can make that money with that platform. But from a company point of view, I'm sure it would be very difficult to go give those remunerations which we would be giving across to a pilot who has higher capability. So these skill sets will differ in their wages. So, you know, it's like we should not consider it, you know, put everybody in the same bracket and look at them in the same bracket and then say, hello, everybody should get 75,000 or a lakh or a 2K in this regard.
Thanks, Oliver. And one more question is about the presence of mind. You know, how important could that be? As you said, pilots, even in any situation, when you are talking about aviation, you need the most important skill is probably presence of mind. How do you develop that skill right from childhood? Now, let's say if I have to play games with my tiny nano drone with children, and I have to at least, you know, start working on the presence of mind or observation or the checklist or the safety. So how do we start with that? Do you have any ideas, any clues or any suggestions which can come from you?
So I'll speak, Rachit sir would speak from his Air Force days. I would speak from my maritime days. And the seafarers, we are paid very highly. You know, I'm a VLCC master. We are paid very highly, close to $14,000-$15,000 a month. But why we are paid? We are paid only for that presence of mind, the common sense. And more than the presence of mind, it is the common sense which needs to prevail in all times. So when you're looking at a class or you're looking at a person or at a very young age, when you want to develop, I tried this experiment with my young kid. And what I did was I gave him a UAV which did not have a, you know, a heading mode, which is called, you call this headless mode. And I gave it across to him for a good, the whole lockdown has been used for it, and allowed him to fly it. It's just a 250 gram UAV. Let him fly. And then when you see that what kind of dynamics he's looking, is he looking at elevation of the attitude control? He learns to move it left and right. And look what he's observing. The things which he is missing, you teach him across. It's the same way when we grow up in ranks, till the time we are in a certain rank, our horizon is limited to it. When we move up across, then we start looking at a different level altogether. So that's a growth. Same thing in a child's behavior, same thing in a person behavior, and same thing when you grow up in your ranks. So more you grow, more you become aware, more you become aware, more you become confident, but at the same time, you become more nervous also. So you know, that nervousness, that height, you know, enlightened awareness will help you to get your more of a better common sense. So it's just the common sense. Some people have it a lot in them, some don't. And I think that's the difference between a pilot and everybody else, all of us. You know, so they're the cool-headed person, they're flying that aircraft up there. And that's the difference between all of us. So yes, some people have in them, some would train themselves to it. So the only way is train. There is no other aspect out of it when you say that they would develop this common sense. So they practice.
I would add into what Nico just told, of course, that, you know, this is something called, you know, situational awareness, SA, which is, you know, normally called into a flying domain. So this situational awareness, you know, is, of course, right to be required to present in everything, not only for the flying, you know, activities or anything, but for anything. When you're driving a car, of course, you should have a situational awareness about the surroundings, who are, you know, applying about, you know, I shouldn't hit the people around. And that's so, you know, we, after a lot of deliberations, we have tried to, you know, make the short-term training in skilling only from 12th class onwards, because we have got so many, you know, guidelines from the DGCA trained master trainers that they should be having all mental faculties good. They should not be color blind, because when you're going to operate, you know, strategically, kind of, you know, that this drones for deliveries, you know, and mapping and a lot of things, when you even operating it for beyond visual line of sight. So all this, you know, the PCM, like what Nikunj was telling, the PCM subjects are very, very important. And so they will be required to be trying to put on all the eligibility criteria also in those things. And secondly, what I would like to also add on, also I may be entering into a slightly controversial thing, but the mothers may not like, but the presently the systems of, you know, gaming, the video gaming is so evolved, the persons, you know, the children's, like, you know, all the age group, they're having downloaded, you know, the flying apps, you know, the lot of, you know, simulators kind of thing going on, PS4, you know, even I have not played some of those games, but all these games have been proven that these are, you know, you know, giving them a very good, you know, situational awareness what's happening around, and even, you know, reflex actions are improving. So even they're recommending it for the older people also, they shouldn't, you know, even shouldn't set in. So these kind of are creating, you know, a lot of, you know, things in the mind, and they're more smarter, much more smarter. Like you told Nikunj, the 7-year-old kid is doing it, but so we don't have to teach them situational awareness. They're already, you know, learning it on the go every day.
Yeah, I just like to add one point that when the kids are small, just let them experiment, let them take decisions and let them fail. Because if they're failing now, as parents, we are there to support them. So it will actually help them to take better decisions later. So, I mean, that is the age where we can mold them in a better way. So let them experiment and allow them to fail. I think that is where especially Indians really need to build up.
So what do you guys suggest, the 5-day training program which most of the drone schools run, what does it make out of an individual?
What does it make out of an individual? Certainly, when he has that, you know, he can apply for that certificate from DGCA when it comes across. And that gives him a permit to fly an aircraft within all the legal boundaries. Other than that, for now, you know, we as a company or as anybody, we need to allow them to fly a lot. So, you know, it's a license which they get, and it's important. At least there is somebody would pick them up to fly. Furthermore, it's a reactive system as of now, though aviation is not in reactive mode, but it's a reactive system. So I think the ministry also will learn, training institute will also learn, and in coming time from 5 days, it may go up to good 10, 15, 20 days also. So it's a learning course. So it started somewhere, and that's important.
No, I would like to add on that the DGC has, you know, prescribed minimum 5 days of course or training course at FTO. And these would be, the people would be able to get the licenses only when they're already trained, you know, as a pilot into the commercial flying and all that. Because they would know meteorology, what it looks like, you know, how the weather would look like, how the surroundings would look like, the aeroplanes, you know, the components and everything. So the minimum, a naysayer would not be able to get the license within 5 days. They are recommending it minimum 5 days. And that is why we are pitching in as NSCC, you know, Sector Cell Council, where we are trying to have a minimum course of 1 to 2 months. Okay, that will prepare them to apply for their 5 days license. That's what we are trying to do.
That's a very good idea, sir.
Yeah.
And we as India Flying Labs wanted at least 6 months, because we want to train them in disasters, in conservation, in data, in AI, in everything.
Exactly, because, you know, this will be giving them a basic license, and the application base for agriculture, you're rightly told, for mapping, for, you know, locust operations, and for the other, so many other applications, you'll be requiring further training on that, of course.
Amazing. Thank you so much, everybody. Would anybody like to have a concluding remark before I request Varun from Electronic Sector Skills Council of India to give his concluding remarks? Varun, over to you.
Thanks, Ruchi.
Your video,
and thanks. Yeah. Thanks to all the esteemed delegates, panelists, and all the audience that we have today. I think really it's been a remarkable event, and the discussion that we have. And just adding on to the discussion that we had, that we have been doing, yes, I totally agree that drone technology, and you know, if we are starting it a bit early, as like Nikunsan sir said, he's, you know, training his kid at the age of 7, something like this, because as early you can start tinkering a mind of a candidate, of a person or a child, you know, so that gives him a quite a lot of experience at his later stage. And that is what the purpose of, you know, our education system we want to, you know, focus on, like the STEM-based education system, which has been designed in that manner only, where they want early learning should happen, practical learning should happen. And apart from the what theoretical subjects, you know, a candidate learns and the labs they go to, you know, they should have the practical hands-on experience. And I'm totally impressed by Nikunj sir's presentation. The first slide that he presented, you know, yeah, I failed, but yes, he and that was his base, and he nailed it. I mean, that's a brilliant, you know, highly motivated. So that's a great kind of discussion we should have with the kids as well nowadays, because there are a lot of competition happening around the world, and every day the pressure is increasing, and every day opportunities are also coming on, you know. So I think it's a vice versa. You know, the more the competition increases, the more opportunities comes at your way. And the better you are at your early stage, the more better you will become at your later stage of your life. So, yes, I totally agree with all the discussion that we have, and with Rachit sir as well. So we are partnering. We already had done a lot of discussion with Rachit sir. The qualification pack that we are making, we are also, you know, want to enroll those critical skill sets. You know, apart from the practical, the core skill sets, the, you know, kind of what and others, you know, basic personality development and things like that, which a candidate should have, the organizational development skills, you know, things like that, which makes him an all-rounder. You know, we don't only want to make him a person of, you know, having all the concepts clear of a theoretical part, but we want him kind of a person who can lead, who can become a leader like that way. So, yes. And I'm very thankful to all the panelists that we have today. A lot of discussion we had it. And from my side, yes, of course, we want to become a part of it in a long term. And along with Kaya Robotics and all the panelists from Idea Forge and other companies that we are partnering with. So totally, I'm concerned with that and want to follow the path what you people are discussing. And let's go for it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Am I? Yeah. Thank you so much, everyone. We will definitely be needing your guidance and your mentoring and your support. And we are trying to do our best with whatever limited knowledge or expertise that we have. But we would need your guidance, definitely. And I already have a commitment from Nikunj and Idea Forge. I don't even have to ask. It's like granted. So thank you so much, everybody. You have always been a support over the last 2 years of my interaction with drones and my attempt to bring an ecosystem of drones for good in India. Thank you so much for being such a generous support and for presenting your thoughts today. Thank you so much once again. I'll see you all tomorrow. Tomorrow we will be discussing a little bit more about the vocational skills. We'll be having a panelist coming in from Ernst & Young and DARC. And we will be having the panelists also from Electronic Sector Skills Council of India. So together, we'll be going even more in depth about the vocational skills. And then day 7 would be the last day when we'd be concluding with policies and the framework for education system in itself, the curriculum. So with this, I would say goodbye to all of you. Thank you so much once again for coming and for watching us live as well. See you all tomorrow.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much,
everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks, Super. Bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Give my regards to your team.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.
Bye.